I'm here with Brian West of Method 8. Brian, could you tell us a little about Method 8 and how it started?
Method 8 started, it was in 2007 of August, August 28th, and I started out just publishing manuscripts. I was publishing manuscripts for years, ever since I was probably about 16, and I just liked to write, and then I started seeing that there was a need. It started out in Youngstown, and I started seeing that there was a need for arts, because arts had helped me when I was in the military. It helped me cope with the stress of everyday life. I always wrote. I wrote about my bad relationships. I wrote about my problems on the ship, and I just kept writing. I loved music, and it was helping me. It was always my outlet, because I didn't have a lot of mentors. I didn't have a lot of people to talk to. So that's pretty much how Method 8 started. And then as I came back to Youngstown and I got to know more people, I saw a need. I started helping a lot of churches out, and I started seeing a need for arts. And that's how Method 8 was born. It evolved over the years because of me not having a lot of mentors. I had to go to school, so I had to start learning how to do a lot, and that's pretty much how it evolved. We merged into the performing arts in 2011, and it's been every year I've learned something new. That's why I always tell people, when they come into business, the learning never stops. Everybody has a different technique and a different way of doing things, and that's how Method 8 began.
Now, I learned about you through my mother. You were actually in a newspaper, and it was talking about a movie that you were doing, and so there was a big write-up. Tell us about that.
Well, the movie business, I knew that coming from a fundamentalist, strict Christian environment, I knew that this was something I wanted to do. And I thank the Vindicator for publishing that article, because when I first started, I had a studio camera, I had a lot of low-grade equipment, but I knew I wanted to do a film that would change people's idea of what they could do themselves. It was never political, nothing was ever political, but I wanted to make a film about what people who have less go through every day. So I made, my first film was a Christian vintage film, and it was about a female who got pregnant and had a baby out of wedlock. But the main thing, the moral of the story, was basically to show people that we don't know what we can bring in the world, the power of childbirth. But that was the decision I chose to make, and I don't regret ever doing that film. A lot of people, when they come into this business or start doing films, they have different goals. But my goal was to always try to inspire, and that's when we filmed that first film. It was tough. I thank all the actors who participated. I still keep in contact with them. It was a local community project, all local talent. I spent day and night, and I even remember the first premiere. I had the wrong version because I was still working for the Postal Service at the time. But that's how the movie, and that's where that first movie, Miracle, The Land of Escobar, came from.
Now, you also, later on, you started helping more people in the community, and you started having agents, and you gave them keys and let them come up with different aspects of what they are specialized in for Method 8. Tell us about how that concept came about.
The concept from the beginning was always to give the talent work. And the concept of the agents were to never act more like agents, but more as counselors, because I knew what it was like when I first started. I did not have a mentor. I did not have help. I did not have a complete vision, but I knew what the voices in my head from the day I got hurt in the military to present day. I knew what I always say God was telling me, and that was to try to develop a place where people could merge ideas. Now, you have to think, I was well read. I was always well read at the time, but the vision that I was getting in my head was never complete because of certain things, and certain things that I knew had to be washed away. But everything happens in time. But that's where the vision for the agency and the community ideas came from, because I knew that when you go inside of an inner city, you're going to face obstacles because there's so many different beliefs. There's so many different street mentalities. But that's where that vision came from. And I knew that I would need people willing to give their time and willing to sacrifice their time and their resources. And I thank them for that. And that's why I always made sure that at the end of the day, I either said thank you or compensated them for their time or gave them something to do to promote their own brand and their own business ideas.
Now, you had a Miss Diva fashion show right outside of your establishment. It was phenomenal. The models did an excellent job. You had singers here. You had people that had came. Limousines pulled up. Tell us a little bit about that. And if I would just throw this in there, my daughter was the first one to win that event. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, that was Ethics Week. I remember that quite well. Ethics Week was designed to promote not only what the idea of fashion and shows could do for local community, but it was designed to put decency and respect into the minds for people who want to approach this business. And I knew that if you take young girls who aspire to be models or aspire to be in any type of art, I knew that they would need that word ethics, because I knew what was happening in the business. I know about certain aspects of the business that a lot of people say has tainted the arts. So I knew that I wanted to put that label Ethics Week on it. I kind of shy away from the word diva, but that's what you're going to get when you get people who are ambitious and who want to be in front. And that's what happens in a lot of art, is that some people have an ego, but they fail to share their talents with everybody else. I battle with it a lot too, being gifted in certain aspects. But that's why I put ethics in front of it, because that event promoted sharing, it promoted sacrifice, and it promoted good quality sounds from each era of from a lot. We used a lot of different just different music and different feels. Everybody got to dress the way they wanted to, and on top of that, we had a stage and we had a fun-filled event in an area that hadn't seen too much of that community-wise. And I'm thankful that the Lord gave me that vision.
And then now my daughter, India Raven, she actually went on and transitioned from winning that event to working with you in the studio and doing some songs for your movie and some of the beats that you made for raps. And tell us a little bit about that transition.
Yeah, see, I came up in the 80s and in the 90s. So the sounds, the instruments they were using back then provided a lot of inspiration and a lot of feeling. I will never discredit any art in any type of environment, because every era is different. We may be in a different time frame, so I don't want to offend anybody. But India was gifted from day one, and her style was unique because she brought not only a feminine feel, but a young female approach to certain different types of art. And I knew at the time we had LaVonzo Williams as an engineer, and I would often talk to him at night, and we would mix up sounds, and I would take basic drum patterns, and she did a phenomenal job for her first project. And a lot of the actors at that particular time, it was their first project, and they did a phenomenal job. We had Sharon Skinner, she did some of the vocals for the track, and it was all of our first time, and I'm really thankful that India was able, that I was able to work with her at an early age. Because one thing I always try to tell musicians and people who are in the business is you never know what you could pass down to the next generation, and you never know how important that art is going to be for them. And when your time is up, and then you have to go behind the scenes, and India did a phenomenal job. That was a great for it to be our first project, and with the cameras and the quality type of stuff that we use, I think everybody did a good job.
And then with Kyra and Alicia Sparks, they were two models that I worked with. I definitely knew that you were doing positive things, brought them over here to start working with you with movies and things. And then you did such a wonderful job with them, gave them the know-how, gave them the information that they need for learning how to model and also learning how to act and things like that. I believe you all were doing Field Angels.
Yeah, Field Angels.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, Field Angels, when it first started out, I wanted it to be a project, a community project devoted to youth cases that hardly ever get solved. And I'm thankful that everybody showed up for the, we were working on, you got to think, we were working on small budgets. Some of these budgets were maybe like maybe $500 to probably even $100. But they came in, they read the script, and it just shows you how there was a need at that particular time for not only gifted people, but gifted people to display and be empowered to believe that they could do it. Kyra would often doubt herself, but she did it. And I think Alicia, she was always encouraging. She was always trying to encourage. I think Jennifer, they did not understand it. Everybody was young, so young back then, but they may not have seen the worth then that they may see it now, but I'm sure people get the picture as time goes on. But those actors, they did such a phenomenal job. They worked together. We had a curfew, but and we had to work on minimal time strains, but that's actually the film that is actually showing on December 6th is Field Angels, but it was a continuation from the Pride Kept It Alive, and that was a good project. Community oriented, everybody did such a phenomenal job, but I'm thankful that they got it done with the little resources that we did have at the time.
I was getting ready to go right into that next. You hit on it with the transition of going to December the 6th, and now tell us a little bit about that. Where is the location? What time will it be? What events will be going on? And share that with the listeners.
First of all, I want to thank Kaylou King at the Holiday Inn. Great businesswoman, especially in the time frame that we're in. We're in the COVID-19 era. They're at the Holiday Inn Express in Boardman. That's where the event will be held. The doors will open at 6. The event usually starts about 6:30, 6:45, 7 o'clock. We'll have a fashion show. The actors usually get their credits for their accomplishments and for completing a project. And then we go into the film. And it's usually a fun-filled event. It brings in the holiday season. The goal for this event is to try to put to spread the wealth around the holidays, if there is wealth, Lord willing. But I invest a lot of money into these projects, and everybody involved invests a lot of time. So we usually have a 50-50 raffle that we try to give away to not only the people who are there, but a nonprofit organization. But the whole idea of the holiday movie premiere every year that we've done has been always to get the talent to display their work and to get people into the holiday spirit, not only just for Christmas, but for Thanksgiving, Hanukkah, any holiday that they may express or love to celebrate, but to keep a tradition. I shout out to my family, because we had a certain way that we celebrated the holidays, and I just figured that I'll go out with my little Santa Claus hat like my dad did when we were kids, and we during the holidays or Christmas we would always have where everybody would get together and have a bash, we'd eat. So that's what all is involved in this event, bringing people together in the arts to come out in their holiday get up. They could dress up. Some of them could wear Christmas sweaters or however they want to dress, or Thanksgiving. I wouldn't recommend Halloween, but that's what it's all about, is getting people prepped up and getting people into the holiday spirit. We have good music, a good time, and then we show a film, but it will be at the Holiday Inn, December 6th, from 6, I believe it ends at 10. The movie is about 1 hour and 5 minutes long, but the event in itself is probably about 2 hours and 30 minutes, no more than 3 hours, but it's about $10 to get in, $25 if you want to eat. It's a great event, especially now, and we're in the COVID-19 age. The Holiday Inn practice has a good COVID-19 strategy. It will probably squeeze about as many people as we can with their strategy. If not, we'll probably get another room. But we will make it a fun-filled event. I hope people can make it out and come out and show the community some support, and especially and try to at least get your money's worth around it. If you have nothing to do and you have a chance to make money, and on top of that, go home with some gifts that you may want to give to your family members. Great event.
And then finally, tell our listeners about your website and how you can be reached?
Oh, you can always reach me. Text me at 234-855-7540. The website, I always post our videos. I want to thank Google and YouTube for creating a platform, the founders of YouTube and Google who invested in it more. I want to thank them for creating a platform for independent people like me who just want to show love and give people a chance to heal themselves through the arts, which healed me, being a military veteran and serving the country. But they can always go to the website. We have multiple links to our Facebook page on there. We have multiple links to our YouTube page. And I was a technician by trade, and I studied in the Navy, so I know a lot about. But the website was built to kind of bring those sites into one site for this community. There's always information at method8inc.com. That's M-E-T-H-O-D, the number 8, inc.com. There's always information on there about what I do as a businessman in this community. There's always contact information, and there's always news stories. We have a news program that I do, the top 8, every Sunday at 6:30 a.m. on the CW. So there's a lot of that on the website, shows, community stuff that I may film, pictures. So that's what that's all about. And that's how you can get in touch with me, usually by text or call. I'm in here from 10 to 6 p.m. at 4800 Margaret Street in Boardman, Ohio, from Monday through Friday. I'm on call on the weekends.
And finally, what is your vision and your goal, your outlook for 2021, Lord willing?
2021 is no different from every day I come in here. It is to expand, to give people an outlet for work, to give people a chance to display their skills. When you've got 100% work rate of the people who have gotten contact with you, and they've been able to see their skills on display, and other people, other directors, other people in the arts have been able to see them do their work or express their or be able to display their talents, I've never been profit-driven. Method 8 has always been mission-driven. So 2021 will probably be the same approach as I come in every year, and that's to figure out what I can do to better myself and better the people around me. And not only do that, but expand and grow and get better. So that's what 2021 will probably be about.
Well, thank you, Brian West, for your time and your vision and your outlook. And thank you for this interview.
Thank you, Ross, and I appreciate it.